The subject of restoration theology is virtually unknown to the mainline church at large. And I don't mean that in a condescending way, but there is a different historical trajectory that scholars in this particular arena look at. And you say, well, Dr. Roberts, what in the world are you talking about? The idea that the early church apostatized and was rebirthed in colonial America has a great deal of appeal to many modern restorationalist groups. Now, what do we mean by restoration theology? Well, obviously, the name implies implicitly that something was missing throughout history. The church apostatized, it, you know, lost its roots, or the spirit withdrawled from the church, as Dr. Hugh Nibley maintains, over generations in the LDS tradition. And therefore, there had to be a restoration. Now, generally, in the Protestant theological movement, we would look at this as more of a revival. But that isn't how restorationalists see this. There's also an element of Reconstructionism, where they believe, due to modern studies of Scripture, or using the King James Bible, or whatever methodology they use, what you have is their particular group, through prophecy or a new prophetic interpretation of Daniel or Revelation, or added Scripture to the canon in the case of Joseph Smith, what you have is new revelation on old subjects that have obviously died or gone awry. So how do we deal with this? Because it's a different interpretation of history than obviously the apostolic tradition is going to advance. To understand this ethos, we have to go back to early America. America was seen as being the new Zion by many, or the new Exodus was taking place from Europe, where the world power base was centered, to colonial America. And in this particular transfer of citizenry, it was seen by many people, whether they came from Sweden, even though most of them were British, or if they came from Germany, they would get off the boat and instantaneously speak with new tongues, or they would automatically understand the English language and have a Pentecostal experience, just like Israel had in approximately AD 30 at the beginning of the New Testament church. These particular sentiments ran high. Why did they? Because America was the new frontier, and the savage Indians were to be subdued by their European counterparts who came to colonize the New World. So it was a mandate from God. How could you argue with the Bible, from sea to shining sea, as Manifest Destiny and the Monroe Doctrine would later claim in the following century? But nevertheless, this idea was extremely prevalent. Also, among the families of Washington and many other founding families was the idea that America was a descendant of the lost 10 tribes. And therefore, a lot of work was being done by the British Anglo societies of the Lost Ten Tribes were constantly being studied. And of course, whether or not you were German or Scandinavian or whatever, if you were descendants of Odin the Great, and if you could trace your ancestry back to Saxony, well, you definitely had an inroad to the Lost Ten Tribes somewhere. Later on, a special revelation, of course, would develop from Joseph Smith's claims that the Lamanites and other Indian tribes were the descendants, as contained in the Book of Mormon. Later scholarly treatments of this would be attempted, even through some of the racial writings that would take place in 1903 in Britain and America, where it was advanced. There were lesser races, and there were, of course, higher racial stocks. I can go into some of my old anthropological studies and see a lot of this, type of genetic type of discussions that, of course, resulted in genocide in later decades in Europe by, of course, Adolf Hitler and other cohorts. But let's go back to the original idea that America was to be the area where God dwelt in his fullness. Reconstructional theologians would try to assert the fact that America would not only be the new Zion, but America would lead the world in a dominion type of theology, such as Bob Jones and others, back to God. That was the historical mandate provided from our Creator. But what else was going on? If you read the book about the light bearers from a Seventh-day Adventist point of view, from Loma Linda, and you read chapters 1 and 2, where they speak a great deal about what conditions were like in America. There was a great deal of famine by the 1840s. The occult, also, which would later give way to the Theosophical Societies of Blavatsky and others, would also dot the landscape with a great spiritual hunger and quest. Had the Christian Church failed America in colonial times? And why was the nation undergoing such absolute abject misery and poverty at that time? Later, you had the Millerite groups that would come to the forefront. And they believed, through studying prophecy and the biblical holy days, that October 22nd, 1843, that Christ would come and establish the earthly sanctuary. Later, Ellen White and others in the Seventh-day Adventist movement, which would be a spin-off of the early Advent Christian movements, that it would be the heavenly sanctuary Christ would go into for an investigative judgment, not an earthly sanctuary over here in Jerusalem. And so the doctrine of the investigative judgment was born as a response to failed prophecies that never should have been uttered in the first place. But we must go back to the early frontier in America and understand who some of the great leaders were. If anyone has access to a book entitled A History of the Restoration Plea by Harold W. Ford. And some of the great leaders of this particular movement were, of course, Burton, Strong, Jones, other Christians like O'Cali down in Kentucky. They were called the Kentucky Christians. James MacCready and others, they were trying to stem the tide against a little thing called atheism or atheism, theism without God. Now, it's interesting here that Stone taught a great deal against Calvinism because that was quite a battle on the frontier church as well. Particularly Stone's work at Cane Ridge and MacCready's was focused at the Cumberland Territory, obviously in the Kentucky area. Now, Stone never denied the allegations that the Cane Ridge Revival were manifestations of the working of the Spirit. What struck Stone's mind's eye was the preaching was done at the meeting and who was in charge of the people who attended. The preachers claimed their particularities in preaching and expression alone in what the Bible means. And see, there's a great deal of exclusionary thinking. I'm adding this to page 7, the first paragraph. The day of religious bickering and prejudice seemed to never have ended, and that's true, clear to this day. And then, of course, you had the Calvinist together with Robert Marshall and John Dulevi and Richard DeMar and, many names. Dealing with the Springfield Presbytery, which of course indicates that human creeds and bonds of communion express a conviction that the Bible alone is sufficient in these matters. Closed quote. And so we could go on and on and on, but I'm just trying to give you a little snapshot into the thinking at that time, and of course, the great denomination that is now pretty liberal of Campbell and Stone became the very respectable denomination of the Disciples of Christ. On the more conservative side, of course, the Church of Christ and an independent group from both of them are still in existence to this very day. The Disciples of Christ, from their Presbyterian side of their roots, have become much more closely related to the UCC that began as part of the Congregationalist movement in the United States and now, of course, has gone more mainline to take their seats in COCA ministries alongside of the United Methodist, the Disciples of Christ, Presbyterian, USA, and Progressive Lutheran groups, and numerous others. There is a side to the Baptist denomination that certainly did not go along with the fundamentalist movements that would rise up during this particular time as well. And obviously, it is the American Baptist part of the denomination and the General Baptist Conference that is also more comfortable with mainline denominations as well. And there are other Baptist sects that are certainly more mainline in their orientation. Some of them will even name their churches after saints, believe it or not. That sounds like a very un-Baptist thing to do. But many of these groups were calling attention back to the Bible or back to Reconstructionalism. Now, what do we mean, Reconstructionalism? It is where the ancient apostolic faith is believed to be weakened or non-existent amongst the apostate groups who are a part of Rome or part of the daughters of Rome. So you can hear in this description, there would not be a great deal of attention placed on liturgy or apostolic tradition or the Syrian church fathers. It wouldn't even be part of the purview or the view of these particular groups to even ask those particular questions. What you have is, when will the New Jerusalem appear? Has the Sabbath been lost? And there are many disagreements among these particular groups, totally unaware of the fact that the Syrian church fathers refer to the Sabbath in Coptic and other traditions over 70 times. But that escapes the vision and the discussion of many of these Reconstructionist groups. So, let's continue in our survey. You had the First Day Adventist, and you had the Seventh Day Adventist. You had the Advent Christian Church, who would worship on the traditional day of Sunday, and you would have the Seventh Day Adventist under the leadership of James and Ellen White, that became an official denomination in 1863 at the General Conference in Michigan State. You also had other Church of God groups that began in 1858, and you had First Day groups such as the Church of God of Abraham and the Church of God of Prophecy that had leanings back to Wesleyan groups rather than to follow the Calvinistic side of the Baptist and Presbyterian and John Knox and, you know, Jonathan Edwards and that stream of thought. You had others who went down the road of the kingdom of God would break into human affairs and therefore would establish God's kingdom on the earth either through the auspices of the New Jerusalem or through the Christian church, as the Reconstructionalists say, such as Rush Dooney in his biblical journals that deal with Reconstructionalism, or you also had Brigham Young's view that it would happen in Independence, Missouri and Jackson County, and of course be brought in by the LDS Church and other Christian churches who would come under their umbrella in the latter times. So, once again, this Reconstructional theology of Zion takes some very interesting forms. Later, you actually had groups such as Herbert W. Armstrong with the Radio Church of God, which he began in 1934 while he was a minister in the Church of God Seventh Day, which he attempted to bring in a premillennial post-trib position. But once again, he held to the Lost Ten Tribes and, of course, the only true church model was something that Herbert Armstrong waffled on quite a bit. In his October 1933 Good News article, he said God had his people in all denominations by January of 1934 on KORE Eugene, Oregon. Herbert Armstrong claimed that the Philadelphia church era had begun, and therefore he was the only one preaching it to the world, and once again Christianity had become apostate in his mind. So therefore you had to be a part of the Philadelphia era if you were going to be in the first resurrection, which was a reversal of what Herbert Armstrong had previously taught, that there were Christians in all denominations. And then when people would accuse Herbert Armstrong of course, a one true church doctrine, then he would say, well, I'm not saying that only our church will be saved, because in the Great Judgment, they would either accept the gospel or go into judgment. So he waffled on that doctrine a great deal through the years, until his death in 1986. Obviously, these groups from the Millerites, which Herbert Armstrong was a derivative of, and there were many other derivatives who broke off of Methodism as well, such as the House of God in the early 1900s, which are partial restoration groups. In other words, they accept through Wesley, back to Menno Simons, back through the Anabaptists, back through the Reformation, back to the Mother Church, through the Anglo-Catholic traditions, some type of evolving church history, generally through a reformed or a what we call Protestant perspective, which is, of course, through the Reformation. And so you'll find varying points of view there as you look at a summation of these groups. And therefore, in the Church of God of Cleveland, Tennessee, or the original Church of God of Prophecy or others, you will see varying degrees of, you know, this particular Reconstructionalism of course, Wesleyan theology. You will see it also through the Nazarenes, who held a very, very, very strong view of holiness through the writings of Purkhizer and other theologians who tried to reaffirm Wesley's statement of the second blessing, were a part of these reconstructional movements as well, even though they do not all believe in the great apostasy and that the church could not be renewed without their thinking. So they don't all go to the level of the LDS church in their reconstructional levels, but they do believe their groups were called for a specific purpose. Even the Seventh-day Adventist Church in its Midnight Cry and other parts of its last day, end day theology don't quite go that far, but they do believe that Sunday was the mark of the beast, and that simply does not fit with the exegetical teachings of the book of Revelation, where Latanios simply meant the Latin kingdom. How do we put all of this perspective together? Even the Jehovah's Witnesses with Charles Taze Russell weighed in. The New Dawn Bible Association and many others are derivatives of Millerite theology, even though they don't admit it. The sleep of the dead and the kingdom of God coming to earth are very prevalent teachings, but so were they in the ancient church as well. The problem is the theological spin that has been created around those issues to say only the 144,000 were admitted in 1933 when the witnesses grew more than 144,000, then it was only a special class of people of witnesses who would be allowed in the first resurrection and in the great multitude to rule with Christ from heaven. And so, once again, a particular denominational bias and spin that many consider to be cultic have been erected in these recent church theologies. Once again, they all have found certain truths, but they become biblically perverted because of their isolationalistic thinking and only their group represents biblical theology, so they can't make the errors of correction that their founders dealt with and erected for self-aggrandizement. Once again, these groups are changing, but very, very slowly, because how do you change from an inerrant position? And how do you change from a reconstructionalism that has placed your group at the top of the Christian pinnacle and everyone else in second position or no position? So that is a brief summation of what we call restoration theology. And we will discuss this in our next lecture, which will deal with the theology of Reconstructionalism.